Welcome to my one day university students. It's good to be back again. My name's Bob Thompson. I teach television and film at the Syracuse University's Newhouse School, and I've been here for 32 years, and I'm looking forward to talking once again about television to you guys. Today's subject is six television shows that changed the rules. And right off the bat, I want to talk about the fact that it's called six television shows that changed the rules, not the six television shows that changed the rules. So there's a lot of important shows that we're not going to be talking about. Sesame Street and what it did to kids' TV. Ken Burns' Civil War to PBS and documentary. Seinfeld and Will and Grace and House of Cards and Orange is the New Black and screening. We're not talking about those, but they certainly changed the rules as well, and they were important. So we're talking about six, not the definitive six. Let's start toward the very beginning, 1951 on CBS, a show called See It Now. It ended in 1958, before I was even born, this was off the air. How did it change the rules? It essentially really sets up the birth of modern TV journalism. It wasn't like television wasn't doing news before that. They were doing it in the 1940s, but it tended to be a guy at a microphone doing radio news on television with a couple film things put in between. For context, this was the fall of 1951, See It Now, when it started. And this is when less than a quarter of the homes in the U.S. even had a television set. Most people were watching TV on a TV set in a department store window or at a bar. Very few people, less than a quarter, actually had a television set all of their own. There was a news show on NBC called the Camel News Caravan, sponsored by Camel Cigarettes, where the anchor, in fact, smoked Camel cigarettes and put them out in a Camel-labeled ashtray on the desk. But that was still pretty much a radio-oriented thing. Then CBS decides to give a lot of money and a weekly show to Edward R. Murrow. Edward R. Murrow, of course, had kind of invented broadcast journalism back on radio. His famous broadcasts as the Second World War was gearing up. This is London, he used to announce, and he would talk about the bombings. Then, of course, his very, very evocative, poetic, and horrifying reports as the Allies marched into the war camps in Germany at the end of the war. So Edward R. Murrow already had a big reputation in American broadcast journalism on radio, and now they've given him a TV show, his own weekly TV show in 1951. Its legacy, let's go through them very quickly. It helps establish TV as the news as a form for television. Multiple cameras, all of this kind of stuff, not just reporting, but occasionally commentary, which is for better or worse. It's the predecessor of a bunch of other long-form documentaries that CBS would do. Most importantly, it invents the news magazine. 60 Minutes comes directly out of See It Now. 60 Minutes wouldn't start until 1968. But Don Hewitt, whom you're going to see in this clip telling us where the cameras should be, in fact, created 60 Minutes based on this thing in the first place. Mostly, though, it demonstrated that TV journalism could actually make a difference. Edward R. Murrow, on this very show, See It Now, took on Senator Joseph McCarthy when he was at the height of his power, the blacklist and all of that, and essentially sets the stage for the downfall of McCarthy. Murrow does a show on See It Now, taking on Joseph McCarthy shortly thereafter. The Army McCarthy hearings happen, and Joseph McCarthy's power is essentially stripped. If you want an entertaining version of this story, George Clooney, who both directed and starred in the movie Good Night and Good Luck, tells this whole story. So let's take a look at the very first minutes of the very first episode of See It Now. And Ed Murrow gets about as close as he ever gets to being giddy here. He was a very straight-faced, just the facts, ma'am kind of guy. But what he is going to do is show us two oceans at the same time, the Atlantic and the Pacific, the Brooklyn Bridge and the Golden Gate Bridge. And to us, this is no big deal. Back then, it was a very big stinking deal. None of that, we'd never been able to do that before. Live, two oceans from sea to shining sea at the same time. And before we actually get there, Murrow is going to bark orders to his person in San Francisco and his person in New York. Only recently could we have had that happen because a cable had only recently been laid across the country that could have connected all those stations together. So what we're seeing is actually really kind of exciting, and Murrow seems excited about it. But also point out how he's essentially giving his introduction to the new medium. We're an old team trying to learn a new trick. They'd been doing great radio journalism before, but television is pretty brand new. So this is the opening couple of minutes from See It Now, November 1951. Hope you are amazed as Ed was.
Hello, San Francisco. This is Ed Murrow in New York. Just stand by. We'll be with you in about 90 seconds from now.
CBS Television, in cooperation with its affiliated television stations, presents the distinguished reporter and news analyst, Edward R. Murrow, in See It Now, a document for television based on the week's news and told in the voices and faces that made the news. Edited by Mr. Murrow and Fred W. Friendly, a public service of the CBS Television Network. Now, speaking from the actual control room of Studio 41, is the editor of See It Now, Edward R. Murrow.
This is an old team trying to learn a new trade. When we started this series of programs, we had to decide where to do it from. We decided to do it right here from the studio. My purpose will be not to get in your light any more than I can, to lean over the cameraman's shoulder occasionally and say a word which may help to illuminate or explain what is happening. We have here two monitors which will serve in effect the purpose of loudspeakers. They are tied, so to speak, to lines that come in from Chicago, New York, Washington, various other places. We will, from time to time, show film on those monitors as well. We are, as newcomers to this medium, rather impressed by the whole thing. Impressed, for example, that I can turn to Don Hewitt here and say, Don, will you push a button and bring in the Atlantic Coast?
This is Camera One at a point of vantage on Governor's Island. We're looking down into New York Bay on the Atlantic.
There you have the east coast of the United States. Now, on monitor two, may we have the Pacific coast, please?
Hello, New York. This is the Golden Gate, the waters of San Francisco Bay leading out to the Pacific Ocean. It's rather hazy out here, Mr. Murrow.
That's fine, San Francisco. May we have the San Francisco Bay Bridge, please?
Okay.
Now, San Francisco, could you use what you call, I think, a zoomar lens and close in on the bridge a little?
Roger.
Oh, that's fine. Thank you, San Francisco. Just stand by for a moment, will you? Hello, New York.
Yes.
May we have the Brooklyn Bridge, please?
Coming right up, Mr. Murrow. There she is.
Brooklyn Bridge. Thank you very much, Eddie Scott. Hold it, please, will you? We, for our part, are considerably impressed. For the first time, man has been able to sit at home and look at two oceans at the same time. We are impressed with the importance of this medium. We shall hope to learn to use it and not to abuse it.
Now, if anybody is still awake after seeing that, and by the way, that only went about 5 minutes. The whole episode was a half an hour. They did other things. Or if you've not had a seizure or become nauseous from that camera movement, you really get a sense of where television was at this moment. This was actually exciting to watch. The fact that we could see live cameras being directed from afar in different directions, and this idea of seeing two bridges at the one time. And then, of course, Edward R. Murrow saying, hopefully we will use this new media for good and not ill. That's not quite how it turned out. Murrow ended up leaving CBS in a huff over the ways it was being used, but that was for another story. Of course, now we have this kind of thing all the time. This is setting up. Think about if you watch the coverage of the assassination of Kennedy in 1963 or 9/11 or any of those things. And they were going to get a chance to start using this stuff pretty quickly. The next story in this very episode was about the Korean War, not live. And within not that many years, we would have live broadcasts from the moon itself in 1969. By the way, we didn't have satellites yet. This had to be done through wires. The satellite wouldn't come, communication satellite, until 1962. They pulled the same trick here, trying to show the Eiffel Tower and the Statue of Liberty. It didn't quite work. One of them wasn't there, so we saw the Statue of Liberty all by itself. Anyway, one show that really changed the rules in that it really starts to figure out how American television is going to cover cover journalism. Let's look at another one, and I've talked to One Day folks before about this. I consider this the most influential television show of all time in entertainment, not in news and other things, but in entertainment, and that's All in the Family. This went from 1971 to 1979 on CBS. How did it change the rules? It essentially allows entertainment television to start recognizing what's happening in the real world. And of course, that happens all the time now, but it wasn't going on much back then. We had shows back then that took place in these, what looked like modern days, but they were these utopias, Leave It to Beaver and Ozzie and Harriet and Father Knows Best, perfect families in perfect suburbs. At the end of every episode, stuff would get fixed up. Even the drama shows, the doctors always cured their patients. The lawyers always won the cases for the good guys. The detectives always figured out what they needed to. The era of talking horses and flying nuns and My Mother the Car. Not that these shows weren't entertaining and to some cases still entertaining, but they tended to completely ignore the real world. Leave It to Beaver debuts just before Sputnik takes off. It ends right around the time of Kennedy's assassination, covers these incredibly complex years in the Cold War, and never mentions any of that. It's like Gomer Pyle never mentions the Vietnam War, even though the Vietnam War is happening, and that show took place in the Marine Corps. Gomer Pyle was a Marine. All in the Family really changed all this. There were a few other shows, Smothers Brothers, Comedy Hour, Laugh-In, that did some of this, but almost overnight, All in the Family changes this. And at first, it looks quite conservative. It's just a family in a living room being presented for us in our living room to watch. We've seen hundreds of sitcoms just this way. But this was different, and we knew it right off the bat. One thing was that a videotape, so it looked more like news than a sitcom. There was some mild swearing in it, which didn't happen on TV up until this point. And then they started talking about the anti-war movement and race and sexual assault and menopause and all these things that you would have never heard of on television before. It was more realistic. The family shouted at each other. I remember watching this for the first time in my house and being shocked that such a thing was happening in my living room. And because it was a hit, it went 5 years in a row, number one. That had never happened before. Everybody else was ready to copy it, and there were spinoffs and ripoffs and all the rest of it. And almost immediately, television moves into the era where we actually recognize the real world. What's happening at the news at 11 is actually now being referred to, at least a little bit, in some shows on the programs before the news. Norman Lear, incidentally, at the age of 100, is still working, is still creating new shows. He presented Archie Bunker, the star of All in the Family, obviously is a buffoon, a bigot who was simply not keeping up with all of the changes that were happening. And that's how he was presented. But at the same time, a lot of people took Archie Bunker as a hero. In 1972, a couple years after this debuted, we actually saw Archie Bunker for President signs, bumper stickers, and all of that kind of thing. Let's take a quick look at a episode. This is one of the most famous episodes and a short scene from it when Sammy Davis Jr. has left his suitcase in Archie's car when Archie's moonlighting as a cab driver, and Sammy has to come back and pick it up at Archie's house.
Oh, Sammy.
Yes.
I was just remembering the last time I seen you on TV. was on a Johnny Carson show.
Oh, yeah.
He was on with that there Raquel Walsh. Remember, Edith?
Oh, yeah, I remember. Oh, you were so sweet to her, Mr. Davis.
Oh, thank you.
Archie said he never thought he'd see the day when coloreds and whites would be hugging and kissing coast to coast.
When I ask you a question, why can't you just say yeah and stop? Now, will you sit over there,
yeah,
huh? And don't say nothing till you rest. You see, Sammy, she takes everything I say out of context, see, because what I really meant was...
Oh, I know what you mean, Archie, but you see, it's not me. See, they put a kissing clause in my contract.
Huh?
Well, you see, it's those white celebrities. Well, this year we're in, so they all want to jump on the bandwagon.
You mean to tell me the networks force you to kiss against your will?
Well, what are you gonna do?
Oh, well, that ain't right, Sam. I mean, you know, to force the races to intersex that way on the air? Now, no prejudice intended, but, you know, I always check with the Bible on these here things.
Oh.
Yeah, I think that, I mean, if God had meant us to be together, he'd have put us together. Well, look what he's done. He put you over in Africa. He put the rest of us in all the white countries.
Well, you must have told him where we were, because somebody came and got it. I mean, there was work for us. I mean, and how could you resist? Free transportation, room, board, chains.
And again, that doesn't seem surprising at all by our standards today, but in 1971, when that particular episode played, this was not the kind of thing we saw on television. Even simple things like bodily functions. It was an episode, one of the very early ones, that we open on the Archie Bunker's living room, and there's nobody there, and we hear a flushing sound. And then Archie comes onto the top of the stairs and descends the stairs. I used to call that the flush heard round the world, because actually we never had acknowledged before that people on television actually went to the bathroom. We didn't even acknowledge, as you all probably know, most husbands and wives, even if they were married, well, all husbands and wives are, slept in separate beds right up until the end of the 1960s in almost all television. So All in the Family, by really embracing the real world, the real body, the real issues, and becoming so successful in doing it, finally, after decades, brings television out of this Edenic utopia that so many of the programs existed in and began to reflect some of the things that were happening in the real world. Let's go ahead to late in that same decade, the 1970s, to a miniseries called Roots. This played in 1977. 8 nights in a row, 12 straight hours, and broke all ratings records that were being held at the time. How did it change the rules? It essentially establishes the viability of the limited series, the idea that you could actually tell a story that has a beginning, a middle, and an end, and then stop it, which of course is not the way television normally works. Television is done by series, which are efficient, they're habit forming, they're easy to promote. You get people who like stars, keep watching them. You use the same sets over and over. The miniseries, while it was played a lot in the United Kingdom, was not something that was part of the economies of early television. Roots wasn't the first. There was a show called QB7 that played two parts in the early 70s, 1974. That same year saw Rich Man, Poor Man, a 12-part series. Both on ABC. So we'd seen these before, but Roots was the first one to have these massive ratings, and it really establishes the future of the miniseries, which dominated a good portion of the end of the 70s into the 1980s. The idea of adapting best-selling novels, which was how we got into this. A best-selling novel sold millions of copies. You had a guaranteed audience, and all of these miniseries that played during this period were based on novels. you couldn't really make a series out of a novel because it ended, and hence we got these limited series. Roots was based on Alex Haley's novel by the same title, which was lightly based on his own ancestry, which he had traced back to 18th century West Africa. It was the first real blockbuster miniseries, 130 million viewers total across the 8 nights, an average of 80 million each night that it played, which was the largest viewership ever at the time for any television episode. MASH would later in its final episode break that, and Dallas, which we'll get to in a second, would break that record at a number of Super Bowls as well. The cast was huge and breathtaking, many characters over several centuries, from Maya Angelou to O.J. Simpson and lots of people in between. As I said before, its fabulous success bred all kinds of other miniseries, Winds of War, Shogun, The Thornbirds, lots of others. The limited series was important for Americans to do. It's good to occasionally be able to tell a story that has the old Aristotelian beginning, middle, and end. And American TV, as I said, was not good at that. If you had a successful story that you told, you wanted to stretch it on year after year, get more and more episodes, more valuable in reruns, and all of that. If Beethoven had written the Fifth Symphony for television, back in the 1970s, they would have listened to it. They would have said, oh, that's wonderful. Can you give us another movement? Which, of course, would have ruined the symphony. But there is a sense that stretching these things out was important. Even today, by the way, limited series that get really good ratings tend to be stretched sometime beyond their source material. Game of Thrones was based on a bunch of novels. When they ran out of novels, they kept going. Clip we're about to show is from the first half hour set in 1750 in the Gambia. Kunta Kinte's, Alex Haley's ancestor, hasn't left Africa yet. And notice how this shows his family here as a happy family. There's almost occasional moments that could be sitcomic. There's a little bit of comedy in it. Also pay attention to who's playing Kunta Kinte's mother. She gives birth to him here in the beginning. That's Cicely Tyson. She goes way back to East Side, West Side, which she starred in with George C. Scott, the first co-starring role for a Black actor. And she continued to work right up to How to Get Away with Murder, House of Cards, well into her 90s. She was given a Presidential Medal of Freedom by Barack Obama. She won an Oscar, an Emmy, a Tony, Peabody Awards, and passed not too long ago at the age of 96. So here's from the first episode toward the beginning of Roots, 1977.
A very strong son.
Being born is hard work.
It will give him a very good life.
We've given him life, Binta. Good or not good, that is for Allah to say.
What do you call him?
We call him Baby Boy. And we'll go on calling him that until his father decides on a name for him 8 days from today.
Peace be unto you. And unto you, brother. Brimasase, you are the most important man in the village.
Huh? Yes, that is true.
Well, tell me, which is best? You know about these things. Should a child be named after a person or a thing.
Tomorrow there are no rules. Whether it is a person or a thing, the child will take on 7 of the characteristics of that name. A person or a thing, it shall be for you to choose.
I hope, Remus, to say that a man of your great learning will not be offended if I say that you've helped me a very small amount.
Amoro, tell me this. Do you believe your wife, Beant, has been faithful to you?
Beant? Why, yes, I know she has.
Is truly the father of the child born to Beant?
Yes.
If the child is truly yours, then so is the problem. I have lessons I must teach.
Greater than yourself.
That, of course, was one of the iconic scenes, and there were a number of them of Roots. And again, a audience of just enormous proportions. We had never had that percentage watching a specific TV show before that. Let's go on now to number 4. TV that show that changed the rules right around the same time as this, and that's the show Dallas, the series Dallas. This is how it changed the rules, because it introduced serialization as stories that could actually continue from episode to episode. Now, the miniseries, as we just pointed out, did that in a story that started, had a middle, and ended. Roots went 8 nights, and then it was over. Dallas now brings the idea of continuing stories to an ongoing series. Now, it's not like this hadn't been done before. The daytime shows were doing it all the time. The soap operas went back, forget to the beginning of television. They went back to the early days of radio. Guiding Light was on radio for 15 years from 1937 to 1952 before it was picked up for another many decades on television. But primetime didn't have continuing storylines. There were a few exceptions. Some of you may remember a show from the 60s called Peyton Place that was much more like a daytime serial at night. It even had multiple days per week that they broadcast. But for the most part, there was a reset button pushed at the end of every episode of a TV series, and there was very little continuing anything from one episode to the next. And television is actually better at having stories developed, that characters that can develop over time, over long periods, than pretty much any other medium. A novel has to end after, 900 pages. An opera ultimately ends, even though it seems long. Films can only be 2-3 hours long, and they might do series, but those are over years. Television is uniquely position to be able to tell these long stories with very complicated, sophisticated development of stories and characters over time. And I don't think television could actually really reach its potential as an art form until it finally started doing this. And network executives were afraid. Soap operas are one thing. They play every day. There's no reruns during the summer. But primetime has a long period where they're not seeing new episodes. There's only 22 episodes per year. People are going to forget what happened. That was the idea of primetime. Well, Dallas comes along and proves them wrong about this. It starts out in 1978, has some modest ratings, but then it ended its third season where the main character, also interesting for a television show, the main character was a bad guy, J.R. Ewing, rich oil magnate. He gets shot at the end of the third season, final episode, cliffhanger kind of thing. Again, cliffhangers on television were kind of unheard of because they didn't have continuing stories. Every single person in the entire show had a motive to kill this reprehensible guy. So this became the big question of the entire summer as to who shot JR. Everybody now knew about this show. Vegas bookies were taking odds on this. And then because of a writer's strike and CBS's desire to stretch it out, we had the cliffhanger, the final episode, in March of 1980. We didn't actually find out who shot JR until an episode in November of 1980. So this was stretched out for a long, long, long period of time. 85 million people watched that episode that finally revealed JR's shooter. Three quarters of the entire TV audience that night were watching. It became the highest rated TV episode of all time, beating previous episodes that were held by Roots. And it's still only second only to the final episode of MASH, if we don't include football games, Super Bowls. Here's the moment that, of course, everybody remembers most, where we finally get the reveal. And this is from 42 years ago, so I hope I don't have to give a spoiler alert as to who shot JR. But I guess if you've been waiting for just the right time to learn this valuable information from television history, you may want to hold your ears.
Sue Ellen, I brought you things.
Regular angel of mercy, aren't you? So supportive. Keeping my secrets, taking me in.
What happened? What are you talking about?
I have finally figured everything out, that's all. You have been trying to frame me.
Oh, you're crazy.
Well, you were right. I was at that condo that night, looking for JR. And yes, I did have his gun. But you saw how drunk I was, and you still gave me a drink. Knowing I'd put the gun down to take it.
Who's there?
You went to the office that night with JR's gun. It was you, Kristen, who shot JR.
Kristen, of course, is the sister of JR's wife. JR has had his wife committed to a what he called an insane asylum because he didn't want her to get onto this. And right after we find out who shot JR, we also find out that JR's sister-in-law, Kristen, who shot him, is also carrying JR's child. This is all typical of Dallas, and it was an enormous hit. 1, 2, and 3, back and forth with 60 Minutes and Dynasty, another slightly later nighttime soap, through a good portion of that decade that it was on. It was a lathery soap. I don't think we're going to give Peabody Awards to Dallas. But it did something very important. It really did change the rules because it did let network executives know that not only could continuing storylines, cliffhangers over time, be accepted by audiences, but they had an enormous appetite for these things. And it opened up the door to what we call the second golden age of television. Shows like Hill Street Blues now would take this idea and they would develop these literary, sophisticated, complex, continuing stories over not only entire seasons, but multiple seasons. Television as a serial art form, what it was so good, was finally liberated in primetime to do that. There would have probably been no Sopranos without Hill Street Blues, and I don't think there would have been any Hill Street Blues without Dallas. So we have to give a nod to this kind of cheesy, over-the-top, lathery soap opera for opening the doors, at least from a structural standpoint, for television to start doing something that it couldn't do when it had to start over every single week. And if you look at all of the wonderful shows now that we have on streaming, and for that matter, that we had on cable the decade before that, all of those shows, almost without exceptions, even most of the sitcoms, are serialized, have continuing storylines. And this was the period in which that really, really came to be. So a nod to Dallas for that. Let's just go about a year ahead. 1980 was the Who Shot J.R. episode, to the fateful day of August 1981, which was the debut, August 1st, of the cable channel MTV. Now, again, if kids think of MTV at all, they probably think of it as that that channel that their parents or even their grandparents talk about having watched about once upon a time and nostalgically waxing on about. Or they might think of it as that channel they see every now and again with all the teenagers that are pregnant on it. But when it was launched in August 1st of 1981, it was very, very important news. It really started a revolution of sorts, although we overuse that word. First, it really changed the way we would watch TV. It changed the style of TV and film in some ways, and it certainly changed the way we consume and think about music. At the start of the new decade, 1980, less than a quarter of people had cable. So cable was not a big thing yet at the beginning of the 1980s. And the idea was, why pay for cable when I can get television for free? Why wait for a cable guy who was more than likely not to show up at the appointment? Why then have them drilling holes in my walls and my hardwood floor? All those horrors that you saw in that Jim Carrey movie, The Cable Guy, back in the 90s. ESPN had started in 1979, so had Nickelodeon. CNN had started in 1980. But these really were not yet must-haves for a lot of households. The big sports events were not on ESPN, but network. There was news every night people could see. The Disney Channel, a big thing for kids, wouldn't start till 1983. But in 1981, if you had anybody in your house between, I don't know, 8 and 29, there was this enormous demand for MTV, because it gave you something you couldn't get elsewhere. 24 hours a day, music videos in stereo. It's what all the young folks were talking about. And you could get a few little bits of videos on shows like Friday Night Videos, but MTV wasn't just a channel, it was a lifestyle. The commercials were different, the graphics were different. It really became kind of a ghetto for young people, youth programming. To go to. And it really starts giving us the idea of how cable is going to fragment the American audience. It wouldn't be long before television prices had come down. Dad would be in the one room watching ESPN. One sibling would be watching Nickelodeon. Somebody else would be on another TV. And the teenager would be watching MTV from the moment they got home till the time they went to bed, if not beyond that. It was the only TV channel to date that had a generation named after it. For many years, we referred to the MTV generation. We never referred to the CBS generation or the Golf Channel generation, but the MTV generation had become a thing. I'm convinced that MTV was the fuse that ignited the explosion of cable. Cable was having a hard time getting ground to a beginning, getting people to, in fact, subscribe for the first time. And that demand of, I want my MTV, which was part of their advertising campaign, really, I think, got that started. And then, of course, all kinds of other things on cable happened before. The idea of people performing to things on screen, they used to be called soundies, that were actually jukebox type things with film capabilities. They had existed before MTV, but not to any great extent. This was really something new, where we were going to see television visualizing music. And pretty soon, practically every movie would have a montage of action with a popular song, very much an MTV thing. Miami Vice, by 1984, an entire series created on the idea of what an executive called, we want MTV cops. If you watch Miami Vice, it was very much like that. Entire artists who had already been known, some of them already superstars, but artists like Michael Jackson and Madonna would really take this form to new heights. Michael Jackson would do these elaborately directed things. Thriller is the perfect example of that. Let's look now at the first few minutes of MTV on August 1st in 1981. It starts with a literal countdown, and then the hip new graphic identity. And then they open with this obscure song by an obscure group. The song was already 2 years old, but it really fit perfectly as the first video. By the way, they only had about 120 videos in the beginning. They kept replaying them over and over again. Pay attention to the glitches, and there were a lot. The videos wouldn't start. They'd stop in the middle. But there's a glitch right from the beginning. We get the countdown, we get the first song, and then Mark Goodman, the first VJ, video jockey, is supposed to introduce what's happening on this new channel. And then after another song plays, they're going to come back and introduce the other six VJs that will play through the 24 hours. Cue wrong. So we actually get the first VJ, or the VJs introducing themselves before we get the first VJ, who then says the other ones will introduce themselves later, but of course they've already done it. It was kind of a mess, but it was MTV, and that was part of the excitement. So here's the first few minutes. We're going to play a little bit of that Buggles song that starts it, but I promise you, you're not going to have to sit through the entire song.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. We've gone for main engine start. We have main engine.
Rock and roll.
I'm Alan Hunter. I will be with you right after Mark. We'll be covering the latest in music news coast to coast here on MTV Music Television.
I'm Martha Quinn. The music will continue nonstop on MTV Music Television, the newest component of your stereo system. I'll be with you right after Alan.
Well, all right. I'm JJ Jackson, and I'll be sitting in with the latest video music performances the way they were meant to be. That's in stereo on MTV Music Television. You'll never look at music the same way again.
Hi, I'm Nina Blackwood, and I'll be with you after JJ right here on MTV, the world's first video music channel, all day, all night in stereo.
This is it. Welcome to MTV Music Television, the world's first 24-hour stereo video music channel. Now, just moments ago, all of the VJs and the crew here at MTV collectively hit our executive producer, Sue Steinberg, over the head with a bottle of champagne, and behold, a new concept is born. The best of TV combined with the best of radio. Your favorite tunes are never too far away anytime you tune in. I'm Mark Goodman, and I'll be here this time every weeknight with the latest concert information and music news. Now, starting right now, you'll never look at music the same way again. We'll be right back to introduce the other VJs and the other folks who are going to be with us on MTV.
And if you're of a certain age, you probably remember all those VJs, and everybody had their favorite. Some of them became big stars in and of their own right. But in this fragmented culture, youth culture, which the emerging cable television was doing, up until this period, everybody was watching the same stuff at the same time. And this MTV, I think, represents how that changes. But that may not even have been MTV's most important influence. MTV also starts showing series, not just videos, as it goes along. And in 1992, it introduced The Real World, which in essence, I think, is the invention of American reality TV. We'd had shows like Candid Camera that did some of that. An American Family was a documentary, but that was a real family in their real house. Real World was about taking seven people who didn't know each other, putting them in a city they didn't live in, not giving them scripts. It was like a chemistry experiment as much as a drama. And for 8 years, the networks don't realize what a real revolution The Real World had wrought. I mean, it really was a new kind of dramaturgy, a new way of telling a story. But in 2000, they, looking over across overseas at other things that were being done there, they brought a Survivor in May and Big Brother a couple months after that. And that really does launch the reality revolution in a very, very big way. And incidentally, both of those shows now, more than 20 years later, are still on the air. Big Brother and Survivor are still going. I've been watching television for 60 years, 40 of them professionally. And I have to say, that first season of Survivor was like no other television experience I had had before or since. It's all so commonplace now. We've had so much reality TV, but it's hard to really remember how different it was. It was inventing itself before our eyes. Characters we would have never seen before. No, there were no stars in this. Richard Hatch, a middle-aged gay man. Susan Hawke, a truck driver from Wisconsin. Rudy Bosch, a Navy SEAL, ex-Navy SEAL in his 70s. These were not your usual stars of television programs, and here they were the ones in the that made it to the very very end of this. Again, huge ratings by the time this was over, and it started an absolute avalanche of reality TV that is still descending upon us to this day. The idea of challenges and eating gross stuff, Fear Factor came in the next summer. Survivor in Love, that was the Bachelor. The heady mystery type Survivor, The Mole, which Anderson Cooper, before he went to CNN, was the host of. Freaky mutations like Bachelorettes in Alaska. Yes, that was really a thing. Joe Millionaire. Even the age-old genre of talent competitions came back thanks to the success of Survivors. Parodies, celebrities, MTV even got back into it with the Osbournes. Broadcast television now very much depends upon reality TV shows. Well, if we can only show a couple of seconds of Survivor, I guess we've got to show the snakes and rats speech that played toward the end of the final episode. This scans like Shakespeare. Its images are remarkable. I'm convinced that this speech was written for Susan Hawke, but I've never been able to prove it.
But Kelly, go back to a couple times Jeff said to you, what goes around comes around. It's here. You will not get my vote. my vote will go to Richard. And I hope that is the one vote that makes you lose the money. If it's not, so be it. I'll shake your hand and I'll go on from here. But if I ever pass you along in life again and you were laying there dying of thirst, I would not give you a drink of water. I would let the vultures take you and do whatever they want with you with no ill regrets. I plead to the jury tonight to think a little bit about the island that we have been on. This island is pretty much full of only two things, snakes and rats. And in the end of Mother Nature, we have Richard the snake, who knowingly went after prey, and Kelly, who turned into the rat that ran around like the rats do on this island, trying to run from the snake. I feel we owe it to the island's spirits that we have learned to come to know, to let it be in the end the way Mother Nature intended it to be, for the snake to eat the rat.
And again, after 22 additional years of watching Survivor and other reality TV shows, it's hard to remember how exciting that truly was, and how this reality form with editing and light scripting and all the rest of it was really going to take over so many of the programming spaces. Well, we've spent the last few minutes talking about shows that change the rules of television. But of course, those rules are changing as we speak. Since we started this conversation, major events have happened with regards to how television and how the television industry is going to absorb all the massive change that's coming with the streaming environments and the evolution of all those associated technologies. But much of the seeming infinite amount of programming that we've got today that gets introduced almost on a minute-by-minute basis on the various streaming services, much of that programming, as different as it seems and as more violence and sex and language as it has, a lot of that programming that we're seeing today owes an awful lot to at least one, and in some cases all, of the programs that we looked at today. By the time we get to streaming, which opens up all the possibilities of television, the basic rules and really the fundamental rules have pretty much already been established. We see all of these things that are influenced by early television. The big difference is we see so much more of it. Thank you for watching. I hope you are as excited about this stuff as I am, and I can't wait to read some of your questions and answer them for you. Well, welcome back, everybody. And there's already so many great questions rolling in. So I'm going to start right now and talk fast so we can get as many of these in as possible. Somebody's already asked, told me that they recently saw the Rolling Stone magazine Best 100 Shows Ever. I saw that as well. It named Sopranos number one. And the question says, do you agree? I think I grudgingly would have to say yes. If I was pushed to the wall and said, you've got to put one show on the top, I think it would probably be The Sopranos. Of course, there are others, Mad Men, The Wire, Breaking Bad, all relatively new shows. Atlanta, I think, is going to end up high on that list as well. But I think Sopranos certainly deserves as much as anything else to be up there. If you notice, number two was The Simpsons. Also a totally different kind of choice, but I think ultimately I would agree with that as well. Overall, that list of 100, if you haven't seen it yet, everybody will have a reason to argue against which is higher than what. But overall, the total 100 isn't bad. It covers an awful lot of things. However, we have another question. What do you think the best TV series of all time in terms of pure artistic merit is, regardless of Nielsen ratings? My personal answer to that was a medical drama from 1982 to 1988 that played on NBC called St. Elsewhere. This was doing stuff in commercial television with worrying about ratings. They didn't have the freedom of cable or streaming, and it really did some amazing things. And it, by the way, doesn't get a single peep on the entire 100 list of Rolling Stone magazine. What's next? Someone asked about the Ed Sullivan Show. Sorry, I just bumped my computer. I hope there wasn't an earthquake looking there. The Ed Sullivan Show and how it originated. That would have been a good one potentially to put on this as well. Ed Sullivan, of course, was one of many variety shows. Variety shows were live back then. And of course, between it and the Texaco Star Theater with Milton Berle, we introduced mass audiences to people like the Beatles and Elvis and all of that, all of those folks. Ed Sullivan Show really comes out of a 19th century model of vaudeville. Before there was television, before there even was radio, you had these variety shows would play in theaters across the country, and there'd be a juggler followed by an acrobat, followed by a comedy duo, followed by an opera singer, all kinds of stuff. And people would come in and watch them. The Ed Sullivan Show and most variety shows on television came right out of that. Matter of fact, vaudeville was what that was called when it was live. Vaudio is what they were calling it when it was starting on early television. Early television liked it because it was on stage, so it could be shot live, even though you had huge cameras. It was predictable, and it was relatively inexpensive. And of course, television was live back then. TV was also based in New York, and that's where a lot of the vaudeville actors were as well. Question, I would have thought The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson, MASH, and Saturday Night Live would have all been on your list. Yes, as I said at the beginning of that thing, this is a list of six shows that were influential, but not the definitive six. And all of those would have been good candidates. Late night television existed before Johnny took over in the early 1960s. Steve Allen, Jack Parr had done The Tonight Show before that, and had really begun to establish what its format was going to be. But Johnny really put that all together, and for all of the completely different kind of comedians that are working late night who have really kind of become anti-Johnny, the format is still really similar. You've got a desk, you've got interviews. People like Letterman, who went on and kind of did the reverse of The Tonight Show, and Kimmel and all these others that are working in that tradition, are still doing an awful lot of the same stuff that Johnny did way back in the 1960s. So that would have been an important thing for late night. By the way, The Today Show, which started 2 years before The Tonight Show, also doesn't look that different than it did back then. Saturday Night Live, of course, extending our viewership further into the week on Saturday. And the very fact that that's closing in on 50 seasons, it's in its 48th now, shows that it's, one, along with Meet the Press, one of the biggest legacies on TV. 60 Minutes also has been on longer than that. Okay, let's go to the next one. Oh, do you think MTV was more influential when it just played music or when it incorporated TV shows as well? That's a really interesting point. Many people who grew up with MTV videos constantly said, oh, I used to love MTV, but they don't play videos anymore. And that was true. I think their influence in the beginning, as I talked about a minute ago, was because you had all these kids that wanted to see videos, and there weren't that many other places on regular TV to see them, maybe Friday Night Videos and a few others. And therefore, it got that cable explosion started. However, whenever they started doing new series, Singled Out was a game show sort of thing, Jenny McCarthy, Remote Control, a game show based on TV shows, those shows always did better than when they were just playing videos. They got higher ratings, more people were watching. And then I think MTV's influence shifted. First, as being a video player, it brought television into the stereo age and got a bunch of people to get a cable subscription. But then it kind of invents reality TV, as we talked about before with the Real World. And then even shows like The Osbournes move reality TV into the next generation, so to speak. And of course, the Jersey Shore and all of that. And if any of you are interested in 16-year-olds who are pregnant, you know MTV is the place that you go for that kind of programming. With the proliferation of streaming, do you think there is simply too much TV now? Have we replaced quality with, and I didn't get the rest of that, but probably quantity maybe? If you want my opinion, if there's too much, yes, absolutely. I have to keep up with this stuff, and it's almost impossible. My joke is, since we started this conversation, Netflix has probably released three new series.
there is a lot of it, but there also are a lot of books. There's a lot of other things. One needs to decide. You can't keep up with everything like you could back in the old network days. And even though there's a lot of really good stuff out there, more than there ever was in any other era, there's also a lot of bad stuff as well. As to whether we're in this, if they keep going peak TV, if we're going to reach some saturation point that all these streaming services aren't going to be able to keep making this quantity of stuff, I think we are finally, for all the predictions that turned out not to be true, sooner or later they are going to be true. We can't continue this vertical growth of the number of scripted shows on the air because the business model ultimately won't be able to support that. Oh, all these good questions. What was the first show broadcast in color? NBC develops a color system that gets established as a norm way back in the 1950s. And they started showing shows in color back then. Amal and the Night Visitors, an opera made especially for television, was done in color. Not too much later than that, Peter Pan was shown in color. And a lot of these played before virtually anybody had a color television set. So NBC played some of those. Color TV wasn't kicking in, much like HDTV took a long time to kick in, and 3D TV never really kicked in yet and probably won't. So from 1954 to 1964, 10 years, color was in existence. You could actually buy color TV. There were some color programming, but for the most part, very few people, less than 5%, I think, in 64 had a color TV, 5% of American homes. So you kind of get it backing off. So if you, anybody here who grew up in the 1960s knows that it was about 64 or 65 that all these color shows started happening. And you didn't notice that if you were lucky, unless you were lucky enough to have one. Bonanza was one of the first biggies in color. And then shows went over. Gilligan's Island started in black and white, moved to color. Andy Griffith Show, same deal. I Dream of Jeannie, Bewitched. By the middle of 1960s, almost everything was on color. And by 1970s, everything was. And of course, they bragged about it. If you're old enough, you remember that Peacock, NBC presents the following show in living color. CBS had the big color logo, and the Wonderful World of Disney became the Wonderful World of Color on Sundays, and it had butterflies and fireworks. It was like a hallucination. It was trippy color all over the place, and it made me regret that we didn't have a color TV. I was watching all these fireworks and butterflies and paint palettes with Tinkerbell and all the rest in blacks and whites and grays. I thought you'd choose the Twilight Zone. Well, that was that another would be a good candidate for the next list. Twilight Zone was one of the ways the anthology show was kept alive, completely independent programs week after week after week, only united by Rod Serling, born, by the way, in Syracuse, New York. His narration and the kind of macabre, supernatural, whatever you want to call it, things. Twilight Zone and Star Trek were almost were also two of the very few shows that were talking about social issues. And of course, these shows both played in the 1960s when there were a few social issues going on. Most network TV was afraid to touch any of that stuff back then. The Twilight Zone and Star Trek could do that because it slipped in on the Trojan horse of being in another universe, happening somewhere else, being something supernatural. And those shows did a lot of important kinds of things that the shows that took place in the real world never did. There was another one up here. What about Star Trek? The same, that same thing. And I guess that's pretty much the same answer. Star Trek, with the first one around, only lasted three seasons. And that show, like the Brady Bunch, became the huge cultural phenomenon it did, not in its first runs, but after several years after, when people were watching it after school, on the weekends, in reruns. Some of the hits we think of as some of the most influential or memorable or iconic, whatever word you want to use, television shows, in fact, didn't do very well their first time around. The Brady Bunch never made it to the top 30 in any of its seasons. Leave It to Beaver never made it to the top 30 in any of its seasons. And I don't believe Star Trek ever got to the top 30 in any of its seasons. There was a another question attached to that one. Was that the first show where the fans stopped the network from canceling a show after season two? It's hard to answer those questions definitively. Networks love to talk about, especially in the 70s and 80s, how the fans saved the show. It becomes a marketing thing. Designing Women probably was really saved by the fans. Cagney and Lacey, CBS liked to claim that. I'm not sure that was the whole reason. And the same with Star Trek. It's really hard to go back and kind of figure out what of the many variables that made people decide what they're going to cancel and what they're going to renew and how those decisions get made. And usually it was the numbers. If they thought they could get higher ratings in another program in the time slot, they'd do it. But sometimes they did it out of a series of the pride of the executives who were running the place. And remember, the networks back in Star Trek's era weren't part of these huge corporate umbrellas. The head of the network could actually make decisions to both get rid of things and to keep them. Hill Street Blues got renewed for a lot of reasons in the beginning in the 80s, but it didn't hurt that Grant Tinker was the head of programming at NBC, and he had been at the head of the company of MTM that created Hill Street Blues. What else have we got here? Oh, someone talked about some of the comedies like Seinfeld, for example. Seinfeld really does, I think, deserve to be mentioned in the highly influential things. Not that it was that new of a form. It was a sitcom about a bunch of people who knew each other. But the very fact that it really moved into, it wasn't about these episodes of, does mom want this surprise party or not? And then we all decide. Or the kids throw a party when they think mom and dad are gone and they come back too soon. Seinfeld and having these episodes all about standing in line at a Chinese restaurant, or all about losing your car in a parking garage, which could have been played in an off-Broadway theater as much as in an episode of Seinfeld. That really was moving in directions that we hadn't moved in before. And to a great extent, what Seinfeld did was influenced and in many ways was ripped off by the likes of Friends, Ellen DeGeneres' sitcom, in fact, even before that, and become kind of a dominant form in the sitcom, which of course has been going on since the age of radio and will be the genre that never fully dies. If you ever really want to get rich creating television, forget all this fancy Sopranos and Game of Thrones and all the rest of it. If you create a really, really successful sitcom, those things rerun forever. And Chuck Lorre, who created 2 1/2 Men and The Big Bang Theory, has probably made $1 billion since the first question I answered today. That's a little bit of an exaggeration, but surprisingly, not much. One other quick thing we want to make a nod to would be Sesame Street. In many ways, we've talked a lot about MTV, but MTV in many ways and music videos in general really were kind of ripping off the Sesame Street style, which was to take this idea of your ABCs and counting and turn it into these, again, trippy kinds of visual, lots of cuts and all the rest of it. That whole generation that grew up on Sesame Street were just ready, and MTV was ready and waiting to appeal to them with a more adult fare. So in an odd kind of way, the influence of MTV we might bring back to Sesame Street in the 1960s. Well, that was a lot of questions. I'm sorry I talked so quickly. This was really great fun. Wish we had a lot more time to talk. And I think they're going to post my email. If anybody didn't get their questions answered, I'll be glad to look at those after we talk today. Thanks a lot for joining us.